Today, many of the cities of the southeastern United States, like Raleigh and Durham in North Carolina, Richmond, Virginia, and Lexington in Kentucky, are flourishing industry, trade, and transportation. Their prosperity is based upon the three main products of the southern earth: cotton, peanuts, and tobacco. Of the million odd Americans who in one way or another depend for a livelihood on these three southern crops, many thousands are engaged in the tobacco business alone. Each year, during the summer months, a green carpet of growing tobacco stretches across seven of the southern states. From the broad leaves of this American plant come cigarettes and the other tobacco products which have been known throughout the world for over 300 years. The manufacture of a cigarette begins after the leaf is aged for many months in tobacco warehouses. From these big warehouses, the hogsheads of mellow, dry leaf are taken to nearby factories. When tobacco comes from the warehouse, it is stiff and dry and cannot be handled easily. So it is placed into a steam chamber to be made pliable. After the tobacco comes from the steam chamber, the leaves are pulled apart and fluffed out. As the leaves are separated, they are grated and placed in baskets. Miles of gravity chutes, air pressure pipelines, and belting move the tobacco on its journey through the factory. Before anything further can be done, the tobacco leaves must be rid of their tough, fibrous stems. Quick-fingered girls untie the pliant hands of tobacco and feed the loose leaves into a machine which pulls the fine, tender body away from the stem and veins in the center. The stems are taken away to be processed by chemical companies into insecticides and other products. After being stemmed, the tobacco is ready for the blending process, which takes place in big bins fitted with mechanical mixers. First, several types of bright tobacco are mixed together. Then, different types of burley are blended before being mixed in with the brights. Finally, the brights, the burleys, some Maryland, and some aromatic Turkish from abroad are brought together in large revolving drums. Is now ready for slicing. The slicing is done by a battery of machines fitted with keen rotary blades. These knives whirl around like an airplane propeller. Fluffy masses of blended tobaccos are taken by conveyor belt to the cigarette-making machines. In the cigarette-making part of the factory, miles of paper ribbon are rolled around the cut tobacco. Each of the machines makes 1,200 cigarettes a minute, or 20, a package full, every second. Thank you. large factories, there are hundreds of these machines turning out billions of cigarettes each month. When the finished cigarettes arrive at the packaging machines, they are not wrapped up, but are inserted, 20 at a time, into the packages which other machines have made before the cigarettes arrive. Upon each package is placed the United States government Internal Revenue stamp. Each stamp yields the federal treasury 7 cents. Moisture-proof cellophane to keep the cigarettes fresh comes last, together with a red cellophane pull which makes the package easy to open. Then the packages of cigarettes are placed into cartons to travel to the ends of the earth. The world's demand for cigarettes and other tobacco products provides employment not only for the thousands of workers in city factories, but creates a livelihood for thousands of other people who live in the smaller communities of the tobacco belt. These towns and villages are little capitals of the tobacco industry, which began when John Rolfe of the Virginia colony first cultivated tobacco in 1612. His successors are the men who grow tobacco today. In the post offices or federal buildings of many southern towns are the offices of the county agricultural agents, who represent the government's interest in the practical problems of growing tobacco. Here, the southern farmer can find the latest information on prices, cultivation methods, disease and insect control. Supported by the government and by southern universities, model farms are also at the disposal of tobacco growers. The experimental stations are developing not only the finest quality of American tobacco, but are seeking to improve the working conditions of the men who grow it. The American tobacco business really begins on farms along the backcountry roads. In February, while the chill of winter still hangs in the air, the growing or making of tobacco has its start. It takes a mere teaspoonful of seed to produce the plants that in time will cover 5 whole acres. As in the days of John Rolfe, the seeds are mixed with fine sand or ash or meal to make their sowing more even. To protect them from winds and frost or too much sun, the seedlings in their nursery beds are tucked in with a covering of gauze. A few weeks later, when spring comes in, it is time for the fields to be put to the plow and made ready for fertilizing. All over the South, farmlands are made ready with ridges and furrows for the warm day when the tobacco crop will be set out to grow. When that day comes, the farmer and his hands start to move the seedlings from their bed to a more permanent home. Out of that one teaspoon, 25,000 plants have sprouted. In transplanting, in every step of making tobacco, the farmer himself directs the work. He must make sure the plants are well spaced out to allow room for their broad leaves to grow and to give them enough earth for the food they will need before harvest. The seedlings are set firmly in the earth early in the day, so the hot southern sun won't dry out the tender leaves. From transplanting on, a tobacco family is a busy family. Field work starts at sunup. But even mid-morning latecomers can help, and they're always welcome. When some 10 days after planting, the young plants are tall enough for cultivating, loosening and pulverizing the soil by machine and by hand, cutting away the weeds and wild grass so roots can breathe and grow deep. Full growth comes during the hot days of July and August. In the 3 months since they were transplanted, the tobacco plants have shot up to man size and bear king-size leaves. The time is ripe for another process called topping. Row by row, the flower stems are broken off to direct the plant's full strength into developing even bigger, broader leaves, the kind that makes the best tobacco. In the weeks around topping time, play and work go hand in hand for tobacco youngsters. Soon, when the harvest is ready, the lanes around the farm will be busy with wagon loads of tobacco, and the ponies will temporarily be put to pasture. In mid-July, the harvest season begins and stretches over into September, a long time as harvests go. Most tobacco is picked a leaf at a time, which is handled separately on its day of ripening. First, the heavy lower leaves, then the fine wrappers in the middle, and finally the tips, until the last plant stalk is bare. The yield from only 1 5-acre plot, from 1 teaspoonful of seed, is calculated at over 700,000 leaves, which means trip after trip between field and barn for mules and sleds and wagons. Work can be fun when shared by friends, like stringing the leaves for curing. Hardly a member of the family circle is too young or too old to lend a hand. When a person is nimble-fingered and knows a shortcut or two, his team may win. The sticks of strung tobacco are sent along to the curing barn by a human chain. The curing barn is not, as most barns are, a storehouse or stable for animals. A special building, developed by tobacco farmers in America, about 20 feet square and nearly as high, stoutly beamed and chinked up for insulation. It is a big, roomy oven for drying the tiers and tiers of tobacco leaves, 1,000 pounds of them, which are racked up to the roof tree so that they hang close together, yet loosely enough so that all can be reached by the air. Underneath the hanging leaves is a stove of clay and fire brick with metal flues which evenly distribute the heat to every part of the building. For 5 days, day and night, the men of the family keep watch over the curing fires beneath each barn, a vigil which may last a month or more on the larger farms where many barns must be heated separately. If all precautions are taken, the radiant heat of the flues in the sweet-smelling barn should by this time be turning the fresh leaves to just the right color. Temperatures may vary from barn to barn and from stage to delicate stage during the curing process. Everything must be checked by someone with a sixth sense in the making of tobacco. When curing fires have died and the barns have cooled, the leaf is sorted and graded. quality of homegrown flu-cured tobacco depends to a large extent on old hands that do the work themselves while training much younger fingers in the examining and feeling of each leaf during the grading process. Grade by grade, 12 to 20 leaves, according to their size, are wrapped in what's called a hand and tied with a fastener of the same quality. When a leaf is of the best quality, it has a texture much like well-tanned leather. The fields are mellowing into autumn in the southeastern United States as the curing season for tobacco draws to a close, and there is now time for other crops to be gathered in. Fodder, grain, and hay will be needed to feed the cows and horses during the cold months ahead. And for the family, there must be cornmeal to make the breads and fritters for which the tobacco region is famous. Everyone works fast and works together, for it's harvest time. Harvest time means celebration, music, and dancing. In the deep fall during Indian summer, market time begins. Barns are opened, things are made ready, and within a few days the backcountry begins to be deserted. The climax of one more long and fruitful season has arrived, as over 1.5 billion pounds of tobacco move to market, where they will bring $600 million to the farmers. At auction time, streets are filled with buyers and sellers, and with visitors. Though big events may be going on in the outside world, local news is most important in the tobacco towns now. The best headlines an editor can print report that this year's sales are heavy everywhere. The auction warehouse is the big tent at market time. Each of the several in town makes an earnest bid for the farmer's business. Tobacco is sold in lots of not more than 250 pounds. Weighed in, it is ready for the sale. The performers follow after the ringmaster of the auction. With quick movements of their hands, the buyers signal their bids, as the auctioneer chants out the sales in language all his own. The money the farmer collects when the show is over is often his entire yearly income in one lump, until the next tobacco cycle swings around. The whole family has come to town, and there's much to do and much to buy. One of the first things a man does with new money in his jeans is to get spruced up. For the price of a haircut, he can talk over the sale with his neighbors and compare notes on the success of the crop. There's a good deal of solid tobacco education handy for the man who listens while he waits his turn. Almost as much as the auction itself, the county fair is a big attraction at market time. Music. those who have been working hard throughout the year, it's fun to sit back and watch others working for a change. It's fun, too, and instructive to see and learn firsthand the latest developments in equipment for the progressive farmer. When livestock is a sideline to tobacco, the planter or his sons may win a prize. For the mother and daughters of the house, there are prizes too. Old Southern recipes handed around from kitchen to kitchen are famous throughout America. Who's the county's best cook is a question that is settled yearly at the county fair. With a dozen prize-winning eggs, a farmer's wife may earn a new radio or an electric washing machine for her household. At the county fair, the products of the southern soil are on display. The most important prizes are for tobacco. In a region where everyone is a tobacco expert, a blue ribbon is the most satisfying of all awards. It is the custom for the winner to answer questions about his cultivation methods and to share his experience with friends and neighbors. Thus, the blue ribbon is both one man's personal reward and as well a symbol of the constant effort of many American tobacco farmers to grow the finest quality of tobacco leaf for the pleasure of people all over the world.